Reading from Srimad-Bhagavatam, Canto 6, Chapter 1, The History of the Life of Ajamila, Text 39.
Katham svidhriyate dhandaha kim vasya sthanam ipsidam dandya kim karina sarve aho svet kati chindrana.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Translation. What is the process of punishing others? Who are the actual candidates for punishment? Are all karmis engaged in fruitive activities punishable, or only some of them? Purport by Srila Prabhupada. One who has the power to punish others should not punish everyone. There are innumerable living entities, the majority of whom are in the spiritual world and are Nitya Mukta, everlastingly liberated. There is no question of judging these liberated living beings. Only a small fraction of the living entities, perhaps 1/4, are in the material world. And the major portion of the living entities in the material world, 8 million of the 8,400,000 forms of life, are lower than human beings. They are not punishable, for under the laws of material nature, they are automatically evolving. Human beings who are advanced in consciousness are responsible, but not all of them are punishable. Those engaged in advanced pious activities are beyond punishment. Only those who engage in sinful activities are punishable. Therefore, the Vishnu Dutas particularly inquired about who is punishable and why Yamaraj has been designated to discriminate between who is punishable and who is not. How is one to be judged? What is the basic principle of authority? These are the questions raised by the Vishnu Dutas. Text 40. Yamaduta uchuhu veda pranihito dharmo yadharmas tad viparyayah vedo narayana sakshat swayambhur iti shushruma. The Yamadutas replied, that which is prescribed in the Vedas constitutes dharma, the religious principles, and the opposite of that is irreligion. The Vedas are directly the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayana, and are self-born. This we have heard from Yamaraj. Purport. The servants of Yamaraj replied quite properly. They did not manufacture principles of religion or irreligion. Instead, they explained what they had heard from the authority Yamaraj. Mahajano yena gatasya pantha. One should follow the Mahajana, the authorized person. Yamaraj is one of 12 authorities. Therefore, the servants of Yamaraj, the Yamadutas, replied with perfect clarity when they said, Shushruma, we have heard. The members of modern civilization manufactured defective religious principles through speculative concoction. This is not dharma. They do not know what is dharma and what is adharma. Therefore, as stated in the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam, dharma projita kaitavo atra. Dharma not supported by the Vedas is rejected from Srimad Bhagavata dharma. Bhagavata dharma comprises only that which is given by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Bhagavata dharma is sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. One must accept the authority of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and surrender to Him and whatever He says. Surrender to Him and surrender to whatever He says. That is dharma. Arjuna, for example, thinking that violence was adharma, was declining to fight. But Krishna urged him to fight. Arjuna abided by the orders of Krishna, and therefore he is actually a dharmi. because the order of Krishna is dharma. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita 15.15, Vedaischa sarvair ahameva vedyaha. The real purpose of Veda, knowledge, is to know me. One who knows Krishna perfectly is liberated. As Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita 4.9, Janma karma chame divyam evam yo veti tattvataha tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti sorjuna. One who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not, upon leaving the body, take his birth again in this material world, but attains my eternal abode, O Arjuna. One who understands Krishna and abides by his order is a candidate for returning home back to Godhead. It may be concluded that dharma, religion, refers to that which is ordered in the Vedas, and adharma, irreligion, refers to that which is not supported in the Vedas. Dharma is not actually manufactured by Narayana. Even Narayana doesn't manufacture dharma. As stated in the Vedas, Asya mahato bhutasya nishvasitam etad yad rigvedaha iti. The injunctions of dharma emanate from the breathing of Narayana, the supreme living entity. Narayana exists eternally and breathes eternally, and therefore dharma, the injunctions of Narayana, also exist eternally. Srila Madhvacharya, the original acharya for those who belong to the Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya, says, Vedanam prathamo vakta harir eva yato vibhuhu ato vishnvatmaka veda ityahur veda vadinaha. The transcendental words of the Vedas emanated from the mouth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, the Vedic principles should be understood to be Vaishnava principles, because Vishnu is the origin of the Vedas. The Vedas contain nothing besides the instructions of Vishnu, and one who follows the Vedic principles is a Vaishnava. The Vaishnava is not a member of a manufactured community of this material world. A Vaishnava is a real knower of the Vedas, as confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. Vedaischa sarvair ahameva vedyaha. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purports. So the Vishnu Dutas are questioning the Yama Dutas, because the Yama Dutas inquired from the Vishnu Dutas, why are you stopping us from doing our duty? So Vishnu Dutas are now questioning the Yama Dutas. They are first of all asking what is the meaning of religious principles and symptoms of irreligion. What is the process of punishing others? Who are the actual candidates for punishment? Are all karmis engaged in fruitive activities punishable, or only some of them? These questions are significant because Bhagavatam is declaring what is real dharma. Vedyam vastavam atra vastu. Right in the beginning, Srila Vyasadeva, the author, has declared that the Srimad-Bhagavatam actually is helping us to understand what is the reality. Now, in understanding reality, one should be able to distinguish reality from illusion. Vedyam Vastavam Atra Vastu. The subject matter of Srimad-Bhagavatam is teaching us what is Vastavam, reality. So Srila Prabhupada says in that translation, it is helping us distinguish reality from illusion. Why? Because from the scriptures we understand in this material world we are under the influence of illusion. But we do not know we are in illusion. We do not know that by ourselves, simply by doing some analysis or looking around us or even cultivating ordinary knowledge. We cannot know that we are an illusion. So the only way for us to know that we are an illusion is when the Supreme Lord or His pure devotees who are perfectly situated beyond illusion, outside of illusion, they take some compassion and then they reveal to us that we are an illusion, provided we are willing to listen to them, provided we care to hear from them and understand. And our problem doesn't end there. After we hear or learn or know, we have to take some steps to actually learn about reality beyond illusion. And the way to come out of illusion and properly situate ourselves in reality. First of all, we have to learn or know or understand that we are in illusion. Then we should also understand side by side what is reality. Merely negating illusion is not enough. Or merely understanding what is illusion is not enough. You should also properly know what is reality. That which is not illusory is real. Simple definition can be given like that. But it's not that easy. Because try to understand the difficulty in even recognizing illusion. Illusion is spread everywhere in the entire material creation. Even Lord Brahma is subject to illusion in this material world. Even in Brahma Loka, there is illusion. So the extent of the power of illusion is not a small thing. It's not merely some humans on the earth considering themselves as intelligent can figure out, oh, now I know what is illusion. This is utter foolishness. Even to understand the power of illusion, the Bhagavatam warns us. In the first verse of the Bhagavatam, the opening verse, Muhyanti yat surayaha. By Lord Krishna, even the great demigods, the greatest of demigods, and the greatest of sages, they are put into illusion. You read Krishna book. Brahma was put into illusion by Krishna. Indra was put into illusion. Big, big sages. One Markandeya Rishi, he is described in the 12th canto. He is a very, very, very great learned personality in the whole universe. He is a recognized personality among universal figures, universally great personalities. He was put into illusion because he desired to know what is this power of illusion of the Supreme Lord's illusory energy. What is the power of this illusion? He was just curious. So the Supreme Lord did put him into illusion and he did not know he's in illusion. The most learned, recognized authority among the sages, great, great sages, he was put into illusion and he did not know he's in illusion. So, it is Krishna's mercy, or Krishna's mercy, which we may get also from Krishna's pure devotees like Prabhupada, that we may be able to understand that we are in illusion and what is the extent of this power of illusion. What is the extent of power of illusion? Then we have to understand what is reality. And after that, we should also learn how to come out of illusion and situate ourselves firmly in reality. All these we have to actually depend upon Krishna, Krishna's mercy, or the mercy of Krishna's pure devotees. Similarly, why I am saying this is to give a parallel. What is dharma and what is adharma? To be able to understand both. Because here you see, it is said, Veda pranihito dharmo yadharmas tadviparyayaha. Whatever is prescribed in the Vedas constitutes dharma. Very simple and straightforward definition. And the opposite of that is a religion. Adharmas tadviparyayaha. Very neat and very simple definition. But it's very, very difficult when it comes to really applying. So that has been simplified. Vedo Narayana Sakshat. The Vedas are directly the Supreme Personality of Godhead Narayana and are self-born. Swayambhu, As Prabhupada says in the purport, even Narayana does not manufacture dharma. The Vedas or dharma, is non-different from Narayana. Therefore, Krishna says, Vedaishya sarvair ahameva vedyam. Because the Vedas are non-different from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vedo Narayana Sakshat. Therefore, the goal of the Vedas, or real purpose of the Vedas, is to know Krishna. So from this we get another angle from which we can understand this Bhagavad Gita verse, Vedaishcha sarvair ahameva vedyah. And Krishna says, to know him, the simple process is sarvadharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. This is a simple, direct process. In the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, avajananti mam mudha manushim tanumashritam param bhava majananto mama bhuta maheshwara. The foolish people, they think Krishna is an ordinary person. So when he appears in his original form, which resembles or looks like a human form, they think he is an ordinary human being. So Krishna further explains in the next verse, Rakshasim Asurim Chaiva Mohinim. What is that verse? Moghasha, Mogha Karmano, Mogha Jnana Vichetasaha, Rakshasim Asurim Chaiva Prakritim Mohinim Shritaha. Those who are thus bewildered are attracted by demoniac and atheistic views. Rakshasim Asurim Chaiva Prakritim Mohinim Shritaha. They are bewildered and attracted by demoniac and atheistic views. Because only due to such demoniac nature or envious nature will someone fail to see Krishna's extraordinary activities, which clearly bring out Krishna's extraordinary position. One cannot mistake Krishna to be an ordinary person after Krishna displays his extraordinary powers in so many ways. It is just like when Vrindavan was affected by torrential rain. What kind of rain? The kind of rain that is devastating. That kind of rain that is generally seen at the time of universal devastation. End of Brahma's day. That kind of rain, 7 days continuously. It's not a short spell of torrential rain. It's 7 days continuously. You might remember in 2005, in Bombay, there was 3 days continuous rain. And entire Bombay was completely, Mumbai, was completely shut down. In Chennai in 2015, not as heavy as Mumbai, but 4 days continuous rain, 4 days everything was shut down completely in Chennai, 2015. So these are just regular rainfall. In Mumbai and Chennai, it was not any extraordinarily heavy rainfall. It was continuous rain for a long period of time. That's all. And that too, just 3 days and 4 days. In Vrindavan, torrential rain for 7 days, the kind of rain that is only seen when there is need for submerging the middle and lower planetary systems at the end of Brahma's day. Because Indra summoned the Samvartaka clouds to flood Vrindavan. During such a rain, Krishna lifted Govardhan Hill and held it up for 7 days continuously. 7 days continuously. So who will consider Krishna as an ordinary person? Only those who are envious of him. Only those who are envious of him. Nobody else. After this incident, nobody else can consider Krishna as an ordinary person other than those who are envious of him. Therefore, Krishna says, those fools who deride him and consider him an ordinary person are attracted by demoniac and atheistic views. They are certainly bewildered. But then the bewilderment is not leading to considering Krishna as somebody who is extraordinary personality. No. And what did Krishna do? He protected the inhabitants of Vrindavan. During such a time when they were distressed, he protected them very nicely. So why should somebody think otherwise? Why should they think that Krishna is an ordinary person? So, the reason is these people who are actually deriding Krishna, they are bewildered in such a way that they become attracted by demoniac and atheistic views. There are always some demoniac people in this world, and their propaganda is going on. Apart from saintly persons doing propaganda about Krishna's greatness, there are also demoniac people who are deriding Krishna. In this material world, both are there. Both kinds of propaganda are there. Always there. So, these foolish people who deride Krishna are attracted by demoniac and atheistic views. They are attracted by that propaganda. And therefore, in that deluded condition, Krishna says, their hopes for liberation, moghasha, mogha karmano, their fruitive activities, mogha jnana, their culture of knowledge are all defeated. Completely defeated. Whereas Krishna contrasts the Mahatmas. In the next two verses, he describes the Mahatmas. Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakritim ashritaha. Those who are not deluded, Srila Prabhupada specifically says, there are others who are not deluded. The great souls, they are the great souls. They are under the protection of the divine nature, the spiritual nature of Krishna. Now, how is it that these great souls who are not deluded, how is it that they are under the protection of the spiritual nature, whereas all these others are under the material nature, influence of material nature? Of course, because of being influenced by material nature, one cannot understand Krishna. That's also there. But how is it that these great souls, those are not deluded, they are under the protection of divine nature? Prabhupada explains in the purport, if you carefully read the purport, Prabhupada says that these great souls actually are called great souls because they surrender to Krishna. And what happens when they surrender to Krishna? As soon as they surrender to Krishna, they are free from the influence of the material energy. As soon as the living entity is freed from the control of material nature, he is put under the guidance of the spiritual nature. Immediately they come under the protection of the spiritual nature. And then under the guidance of the spiritual nature, they exactly know who is Krishna. Everything, they come to know everything about Krishna. So therefore, as Krishna says in the 14th verse, no, in the 7th chapter, he says, Maam eva ye prapadyante mayam etam tarantite. It is not easy to cross over the influence of this illusory energy except by surrendering to Krishna only. Maam eva yaha prapadyante. Only by surrender to Krishna can we cross over the influence of illusion. And what happens when we surrender to Krishna? As is explained by Prabhupada here, immediately we come out of the illusion. We come under the guidance of Krishna's spiritual nature. But such surrender is the difficult part. Why surrender to Krishna? Demons never surrender to Krishna. Namam duskritino mudha. And then there are others who surrender, but not to Krishna. They surrender either to the demigods or they surrender to the impersonal Brahman, formless Brahman. So those who surrender to devatas, they consider devatas to be different forms of God. And those who surrender to the formless Brahman, they think we are also God. Just that now, I am in Maya. When I come out of Maya, I'll realize I am God. So, those who surrender to the devatas and those who surrender to the formless Brahman, they are also not able to actually properly know Krishna. Therefore, Krishna can be known only by devotional service, only by devotees. Devotees mean those who perform devotional service. Bhaktya mam abhijanati yavan yashchasmi tatvatah. So we cannot know Krishna otherwise. And the goal of the Vedas is simply to know Krishna so that we can surrender to Krishna. And what is the purpose of knowing Krishna anyway? The purpose of knowing Krishna is to surrender to Him. And simply by surrender, we come out of illusion. And we situate ourselves in reality. And then everything is perfect and fine. Everything is fine. Actually, it's very, very easy. But then, because we are habituated to speculate, to doubt. We have been cheated many, many times by our taking shelter of the wrong people, misled by demons. So therefore, it's not easy for us to put faith in the proper authority or proper source. Even when somebody hears from Krishna, they may think, oh, is this Krishna a real God or he is also some another devata? Among many devatas, he is also one competing devata. So therefore, only those who are, that's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Kono Bhagyavan Jeev, some fortunate soul among millions and billions and trillions of living entities wandering in this whole universe. Brahmande Brahmite Kono Bhagyavan Jeev. Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Beach. Only some fortunate souls are able to get that seed of devotional service. Because without devotion, it's never possible to know Krishna. And that devotion is possible only if the seed of devotion is sowed in the heart by the mercy of Guru and Krishna, bona fide spiritual master and the Supreme Lord Krishna. Only by that. Otherwise, it's not possible. So, we should recognize our good fortune. We should recognize our good fortune. And do everything that is required to actually surrender. If we have any doubt, because of which we are hesitating to surrender, we should get all such doubts cleared immediately. And it's the need to immediately do so, to get all doubts cleared. Because Krishna specifically asks Arjuna, are all your doubts clear now? Sitosmi gata sandehaha. Now I don't have any doubts, Arjuna is telling. Only then we can properly surrender. If you have little doubt also, Krishna says in the fourth chapter, for a doubting soul, there is no happiness in this life or the next. So we have to become free from all doubts. And in that series of verses in the first canto, second chapter, Shrinvatam Swakatha Krishnaha, the development of awakening of bhakti, the stages. One stage is when all doubts are completely eradicated. What is that verse? Chidyante sarva samshayaha. Chiyante chasya karmani drishtaye vatmanisha. Vidyate hridaya granthi chidyante sarva samshaya. So we have to become free from all doubts. We have to come out of illusion. Nashto moha, Arjuna says, my illusion is completely destroyed. Smritir labdha, because his memory about Krishna is revived. So we also have to come to that stage which Arjuna came by hearing Bhagavad Gita. It's possible by properly hearing Bhagavad Gita. If we are unable to understand what Krishna is telling, Prabhupada's most illuminating purports are there to explain Krishna's words. And even after reading, if we don't understand, we have to read again and again. Prabhupada says that. Read repeatedly. And of course, the reading has to be backed up by proper chanting of Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. Reading alone is not going to work. we have to also chant properly Hare Krishna. Then our illusion will be completely destroyed. Our memory of Krishna will be revived. Whatever happened to Arjuna, same thing can happen to anyone. It's not only for Arjuna that Krishna was speaking Bhagavad Gita. He made Arjuna an instrument. Actually, his aim was to speak to all of us. Okay, I'll stop here. Rantra Srimad-Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna. Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any updates.